Okay, guys, so since one or two of you have been asking for it, here we go with the diecast Disney Store Millennium Falcon review. Let's start off with the box. So, of course, I've already opened it, but for those of you who wish to know, it is a red box. There's a Star Wars logo on the side picture, not of the actual product, but of the Falcon. And in fact, you know, I always throw the boxes away, but I'm actually going to keep it in here, you know, for safekeeping and for storage. It's pretty convenient, so I'm actually keeping this one. And now we move on to the actual ship. First thing that impressed me about it was the size. It is just about more or less the size of my hand. And for those of you who like a more scientific measurement, that'd be about 7.5 inches. So it's the size that really impressed me about this. Now, I say the size is impressive because it's all a die-cast. Top and the bottom. It does have plastic parts, which I guess we can go over real quick. Is the radar dish. The little cannons, both the one on top and the bottom. And then the landing gear. What is that? 4 or 5 landing gears. Okay, so those are the plastic parts. And I can't really tell for sure, but I think, you know, one or some of the side walls are also plastic. Now, here's some other plastic parts I almost forgot about. You have these little windows here. I don't really know what they are, but, you know, they're some kind of viewports, I guess. The other last plastic part is the ramp on this side, which actually does come down. Now, the other thing I really like about this is the accuracy of the proportions. That's different from the accuracy of the details, which is, you know, because this is just a die-cast model. It's not a plastic model that really goes for accuracy. This is not going to be as detailed. But they seem to have gotten the proportions correct, or pretty close, because, what I would reference is the side. Now, just for a comparison, here's the Hot Wheels diecast. Check out the sides. Look how thick that is. From the top to the bottom, that's one thing I always look at, is how thick are the side walls. And they're usually too thick. Now compare that to the Disney diecast version. See how thin they are, and it tapers down once you get to closer to the engine? That's how the model is. Now, from all the reference pictures I've seen, that's how it is. So this one is more correct, and that's what I like about this one. Now I'm going to give you a close look at the detail, which is impressive for what it is, but if you're hoping for something more on the level of a plastic model, you're not going to get it on this. There's a lot of areas where the detail is generalized, and in some cases, like right here, it almost looks like it's missing. But I think it's enough for a die-cast model, right? There's enough detail on there to make it look good. Now there are a few things I'm not too thrilled about with this piece, and first thing right off the top is the paint job. It's not very impressive at all, and in fact it's much too gray. Now I think that's, you know, it's just the color of the wash they used, which is too dark. But the paneling that they've colored in is also really sloppy. I mean, they look like smears. They look like bloody smears for the most part. And then the other thing is the landing gear. With these you can pull them out, and some of them will snap in place. You'll hear a little pop or snap. Some of them won't. So what happens is when you have all of them extended and you try to put it down, if you don't pull them all out properly, they won't hit the surface as well. And sometimes it'll be lopsided. So as long as you pull them out as far as they go, you know, and you set it down gently, it's more or less okay. But if you don't, or if you move it around too much, you know, you get this, or one of the landing gear will pop it back in. It just doesn't stay correctly. So that's the unfortunate part. Okay, so now we move on to scale. Like I mentioned earlier, this is about 7.5 inches. And that'll make it, I mean, from what I measured before, in a more accurate way, that'd make it 19.4 centimeters. And according to some of the numbers that are out there, because they're kind of changing now, with if you notice, you look up Wikipedia, they're changing the pages on the entries. They'll have Legends, and then they'll have Canon. So it's a little bit in flux right now, but the original one, the Legends version measurements, gave the in-universe size of 34.37 meters. So if you do all the calculations and everything, that would make this at, let's see, that would make this at 177 scale. Now, the closest thing I have to comparison to show you is the Hot Wheels TIE Fighter, which would be very close at 172 scale. So, here it is in comparison. This isn't off by much. I mean, you know, in terms of scale, it is off. But if I were to reduce this to the size that it should be, you wouldn't even notice it. Even side by side, you'd barely notice it. So, for all intents and purposes, these are the correct sizes. Okay, if you take the in-universe measurements and all that, This is how big a TIE Fighter would be in comparison to the Falcon. This is a larger diecast. I guess it's part of their deluxe line that includes this one, Kylo Ren's Command Shuttle, and the Star Destroyer. They are larger, so they're at a $20 price point. And for me, I think it's a good deal. Because if you're looking for a nicely sized Falcon, with a relatively nice detail, that's not, you know, one of those really expensive classic models that you have to put together yourself, this is what you want to go with. Okay, guys, so that's pretty much it for this review. Really like to thank everybody for watching and taking a look at this with me. Specifically, I want to thank Manny, MG Villain, Dan, and War Machine Vengeance, who, you know, went ahead and requested this review. Alright, so I'll catch everybody on the next video, which will more than likely be...
One of the big things about, you know, Millennium Falcons in